Meanwhile, Jonathan researches the boxes of earth that were shipped from Transylvania to England. He discovers that all 50 were delivered to the chapel at Carfax, but worries that some might have been moved elsewhere in recent weeks. Mina notes that Harker seems to have fully recovered from his ordeal in Transylvania. Holmwood and Morris arrive at the asylum, and Holmwood is still terribly shaken by Lucy's death. With Seward's permission, Mina visits Renfield. The madman frantically swallows his collection of flies and spiders before she enters, but is extremely polite and seems rational in her presence. Van Helsing arrives at the asylum, pleased to see that Seward's diaries and letters have been typed and placed in order. He compliments Mina on her work but hopes that she will be spared a role in the business before them. The destruction of the vampire, he notes, is no part for a woman. Van Helsing gathers the entire company and tells them the legend of the Nosferatu, or undead. He says that such creatures are immortal and immensely strong, have command over various animals and the elements, and can vanish and change form at will. However, they also have certain weaknesses. They cannot survive without blood, cannot enter a house unless summoned, lose their power at daybreak, at which time they must seek shelter in the earth or a coffin, and are powerless before crucifixes, communion wafers, and other holy objects. To kill Dracula, Van Helsing says they must first track down his 50 boxes of earth. He also resolves that Mina must not be burdened with or endangered by the details of their work. The men tell Mina that they are men and can bear, but you must be our star and our hope. The entire company asks to see Renfield. They gather, and he makes a remarkably rational and passionate plea to be released at once to avoid terrible consequences, fearing that this sudden display of sanity is but another form or phase of his madness. Seward denies Renfield's request. The men journey to Carfax, arming themselves with holy objects for protection. There is no sign of Dracula in the chapel, but there is a terrible stench, and the men find 29 of the original 50 boxes of earth. To the men's horror, rats begin to fill the chapel. The men use a whistle to summon dogs that chase away the rats. Van Helsing's spirits are high even though 21 boxes are missing. Upon returning to the asylum, Van Helsing asks to see Renfield again, hoping to use the lunatic as a source of information. Van Helsing attempts an interview. Renfield curses Van Helsing and refuses to cooperate. Mina records her mounting anxieties in her diary. One night in the asylum, she wakes up after hearing strange sounds from Renfield's room and finds that her window is open even though she is certain she closed it. Mina stares out the window at a thin streak of white mist that slowly creeps across the yard toward the asylum, seeming to have a sentience and a vitality of its own. Mina sleeps fitfully and wakes to find a pillar of cloud in her room. She sees a livid white face bending over her, but assumes this figure is merely part of her dream. Harker's investigations revealed that 12 of the remaining boxes of earth were deposited in two houses in London. He traces the remaining 9 boxes to a house in Piccadilly, a London suburb. Harker's companions worry about how they will manage to break into a house in such a highly populated area. Seward chronicles rapid changes in Renfield's behavior. The patient seems to have given up his interest in Zoetil de Pilcrophagy, but reiterates his earlier desire, saying, "Life is all I want." Seward questions Renfield, asking him how he accounts for the souls of the lives he plans to collect. Renfield becomes agitated at the inquiry, claiming that he has enough to worry about without thinking of souls. Seward concludes that his patient dreads the consequences of his life-gathering hobbies, which burden his soul. The flowing evening, the asylum attendants hear a scream and find Renfield lying in his cell, covered in blood, dying. Renfield admits to the other men that Dracula often visited him, promising him flies, spiders, and other living creatures from which to gain strength in return for Renfield's obedience. Later, when Mina visited him, Renfield noted her paleness and realized that Dracula had been taking the life out of her. He grew angry, and Renfield attempted to seize him when the Count slipped into his room that night. The vampire's eyes burned him, and he was flung violently across the room as Dracula slipped away into the asylum. The 4 men rush upstairs to the Harker's room. Finding it locked, they break down the door on a terrible scene. Jonathan lies unconscious, Mina kneels on the edge of the bed, and the Count stands over her as she drinks from a wound on his breast. Dracula turns on the intruders, his eyes flaming with devilish passion, But Van Helsing holds up a sacred communion wafer, and the Count retreats, the moonlight fades, and the men light a gas lamp. All that is left of the Count is a faint vapor escaping under the door. Morris chases it and sees a bat flying away from Carfax. Meanwhile, the men discover that the Count has torn apart their study in an attempt to destroy their papers and diaries. Fortunately, they have kept duplicate copies in a safe. Mina and Jonathan regain consciousness. Mina says that she awoke that night to find Jonathan unconscious beside her and Dracula stepping out of a mist. The Count threatened to kill her husband if Mina made a sound. He drank blood from her throat, telling her that it was not the first time he had done so. Then, slicing his chest open, he pressed her lips to the cut and forced her to drink his blood. Dracula mocked his pursuers and assured Mina that he would make her flesh of my flesh. Mina cries out, "God pity me! Look down on a poor soul in worse than mortal peril." In his journal, Harker recounts the end of Renfield's story. Before escaping the asylum, the Count pays one last visit to the lunatic, breaking his neck and killing him. Harker and his compatriots go to Carfax the next day and place a communion wafer in each of Dracula's boxes of earth, rendering them unfit for the vampire's habitation. Before the men proceed to the Count's estate in Piccadilly, Van Helsing seals Mina Murray's room with wafers. When he touches her forehead with a wafer, it burns her skin and leaves a bright red scar on her forehead. Mina breaks down in tears, calling herself unclean. The men obtain keys to Dracula's other houses around the city. Holmwood and Morris hurry off to sterilize the 12 boxes that are stored in London, while Harker and Van Helsing leave to do the same to the boxes in Piccadilly. Reaching Piccadilly, the men find only 8 boxes, so the 9th is missing. Mina sends a message that Dracula has left Carfax, and the men anticipate that he will soon arrive at Piccadilly in an attempt to protect his boxes. The men lie in wait, and Dracula arrives. As it is daytime, however, the Count is largely powerless. Van Helsing's crew attempts an ambush, but Dracula leaps out a window and escapes. Despite Dracula's taunts, Van Helsing believes that the Count is probably frightened, knowing that he has only one box remaining as a safe resting place. Van Helsing hypnotizes Mina in an attempt to trace Dracula's movements. Under the trance, Mina's unholy connection to the Count enables her spirit to be with him. Mina hears the telltale noises of sea travel, which indicates that the Count has fled England by sea. Jonathan records his fears that Dracula may elude them, lying hidden for many years while Mina slowly transforms into a vampire. Van Helsing's band discovers that the Count has boarded a ship named the Serena Catherine, which is bound for Varna, the same Russian port from which Dracula sailed 3 months before. Van Helsing delivers an impassioned speech in which he declares it necessary to defeat Dracula for the good of humankind. He claims that the group pledged to set the world free. Van Helsing notes the effect that the baptism of blood has had on Mina and insists that she should not be troubled with or further compromised by their hunt for the Count. The men make plans to intercept Dracula in Varna, and Mina insists on accompanying them, saying that her telepathic connection to Dracula may aid their search. Van Helsing concedes, and Harker departs to make the necessary travel arrangements. Before departing, Mina asks the group to pledge that they will, for the sake of her soul, destroy her if should she transform into a vampire. The men take a solemn vote to comply with Mina's wishes. On October 12th, they board the Orient Express and make their way to Varna, where Van Helsing arranges to board the Serena Catherine immediately after it arrives in port. As the days pass, Mina grows weaker. After more than a week of waiting in Varna, the band receives word that Dracula's ship has bypassed Varna and docked in the port of Galatz instead. As they prepare to board a train to Galatz, Van Helsing suggests that Mina's connection to Dracula may have enabled the Count to learn of their ambush. Van Helsing insists that they not lose hope, however, reasoning that the Count is now confident that he has eluded them and will not expect any further pursuit. Seward writes a diary entry while on the train from Varna to Galatz. He notes that Mina's trances reveal less and less, but are still of some value. Mina hears the sound of lapping water, so the band knows that Dracula remains somewhere close to the water. The men hope to reach Galatz before the box is unloaded, But they are too late. The captain of the Serena Catherine informs them that a businessman named Emmanuel Hildsheim picked up the box and passed it on to a trader named Petrov Skinsky. Shortly after that, Skinsky's body is found in a graveyard with his throat torn out. After Mina investigates the possible routes that the Count could take to return to his castle, the band splits up and spreads out. Mina and Van Helsing take a train homeward and Harker hire a steamboat and Seward and Morris travel across the countryside on horseback. Van Helsing hastens toward Dracula's castle, hoping to purify the place before the Count's arrival. During their journey up the river, Jonathan and Arthur hear of a large, double-crewed boat ahead of them and decide this vessel must be Dracula's mode of transport. Seward and Morris rush on with their horses. Meanwhile, Mina records that she and Van Helsing have reached the town of Viresti, where they are forced to take a horse and carriage the rest of the way to the castle. Mina thus travels through the same beautiful country that her husband sees on his journey months before. Van Helsing hands a memorandum to Seward, writing that he and Mina have reached the Borgo Pass. As they climb the trail toward the castle, Van Helsing finds that he can no longer hypnotize Mina. That night, fearing for her safety, he encircles her with a ring of crumbled Holy Communion wafers. The three female vampires who visited Harker months before reappearing, they try to tempt Van Helsing and Mina to come with them and frighten the horses to death. Van Helsing leaves Mina asleep within the circle of holy wafers and proceeds on foot. Reaching the castle the next afternoon, he finds the tombs of the three female vampires and is nearly paralyzed by their beauty, but forces himself to perform the rituals necessary to destroy them. Van Helsing then finds a tomb more lordly than all the rest, and nobly proportioned. The tomb is inscribed with Dracula's name, and the professor cleanses it with the communion wafers. Finally, he seals the castle doors with wafers to forever deny the Count entry. Mina and Van Helsing leave the castle and travel east, hoping to meet the others. There is a heavy snowfall, and wolves howl all around them. At sunset they see a large cart on the road below them, driven by gypsies and loaded with a box of earth. From a remote location, Mina and Van Helsing watch Seward, Morris, Harker, and Holmwood close in on the gypsies. With the sun rapidly sinking, the men intercept the cart, and the gypsies move to defend their cargo. Harker and Morris muster incredible strength and force their way onto the cart. Harker flings the box to the ground, and Morris is wounded, but together they manage to pry open the lid. Seward and Holmwood aim their rifles at the gypsies. From her vantage point, Mina sees Dracula's hateful expression turn to a look of triumph. At that moment, however, Harker slashes through Dracula's throat just as Morris plunges his knife into the Count's heart. Dracula dies, and as his body crumbles to dust, Mina notes on his face a look of peace, such as I never could have imagined might have rested there. Morris is fatally wounded, but before he dies he points out that the scar has vanished from Mina's forehead. A brief coda follows, written by Harker 7 years later. He and Mina have a son named Quincy, and both Seward and Holmwood are happily married.